Okay, now the subject, apart from Brexit, that prompted more questions than any other was the decision to buy Facebook. And I particularly like this question from Mr. Paul Zimmerman, because not only does he sum up widespread incredulity, but he does it with gusto. Terry, why are we still in Facebook? It feels like a company at risk of turning into a business under attack from regulators, governments, politicians, and its own customers. Management seems to be making a lot of mistakes. What am I missing? Can we get out, please?
Well, we certainly can, but we're not going to. Unless we change our mind, which we sometimes do, and sometimes we're wrong. We think it's a very good business, actually. It's got high returns on capital. It's got a high growth rate. We've expected the growth rate to come down for some time, and it is, but still the growth rate that we expect it to get down to will be very high. I think there's a danger of all of us sometimes working from personal anecdote rather than data and things. So under attack from its customers, you know, the individual users grew 10% last year, basically. All of the growth is outside Europe and America. That's where the growth is basically coming from. There's a lot of potential for growth in the one thing that they make money on at the moment, which is advertising. They have 2 billion users in round number terms, but that's not where the money is made. The money is made from online advertising where, A, they're in a duopoly with Google,
yep.
And B, the number of advertisers they've got is about 6 million, which sounds quite a large number, but it isn't. 6 million also happens, coincidentally, to be the number that Sage, the accounting software business, has quoted for its number of customers. So Sage has 6 million small to medium business customers, you know, so a UK-based account, a nearly global, and it's only nearly global because it doesn't operate in China, social network and communication system, which is ubiquitous outside China, has only 6 million advertisers. I suspect there's great potential for growth in that. Going back to his question, though, he particularly majors on, you know, under attack from regulators. You know, one of the greatest investments you could have made in recent decades has been the tobacco industry. And the tobacco industry has increasingly become a better and better investment the more that governments have tried to stop it, if you like. I always say it's the opposite of the great Ronald Reagan quote. He said the nine most dangerous words in the English language are, I'm from the government, I'm here to help. And seeing what's happened in the tobacco industry, I've become somewhat persuaded that the best industry is one where the government tries to stop you, because they are so appallingly incompetent at it that they manage to make the industry better. And their action in the tobacco industry basically led the tobacco industry to have more regulation. It's difficult for an outsider to get in when you've got the degree of regulation that you've got there. They caused the tobacco industry to have big liabilities. There's never going to be a new tobacco company to compete with these people. They stopped them spending money on advertising and marketing, which had two effects. One is it increased their profitability, and the other one was it made it impossible for anyone, even somebody who was in the industry, to create a new brand or pass an existing brand. And I think something similar is happening in Facebook. I think that the government action on and their reaction to it is building, for want of a better term, a competitive moat, which is insurmountable for any competitor in this industry.
Really, you're nodding. I mean, last year there was a serious, it was more than a blip, wasn't it? There was a sharp drop in Facebook's share price after it revealed numbers that showed user growth in developed markets was slowing.
Yes. I mean, I think the first thing to remember on that point is that, you know, if you think that Colgate's a toothpaste company, it makes its money from selling toothpaste. If you think that that Unilever's a personal care and a food company, it makes its money from selling those. As Terry said, people think of Facebook as a social media company, but you should think of it more as an advertising company. So I think it's quite possible over the next, you know, decade or couple of decades that the actual number of users might stagnate or even go down. The important thing is what happens to that number of paying customers, which is the advertising customers. I mean, the other thing which numbers which I thought might interest people, partly because they interested me as in someone who looks in these numbers in a lot of detail, but sometimes you don't see the wood from the trees in doing so. So all of you who work in a business or own a business or run a business will be familiar with the challenge that something happens and you need to increase your budgets, as Facebook has had to do because of the need to beef up its online security threats, also to pay for all the data centers that are going to stream the videos. So here are three interesting numbers, I think, pretty simple numbers. If you think about the cost of running Facebook, and I can define that later, but basically the cost of running Facebook in 2017, so only 2 years ago, was $27 billion. The cost of running it in 2018 was $45 billion. The cost of running it in the year we've just started will be somewhere between $60 and $65 billion. So you might not like Facebook, you might not think they've done enough to respond to the various challenges they have, but they've actually increased their budget to run the business by about, increased, that's not what they're spending in total, increased it by $35 billion in the space of a couple of years.
And normally, you might think it's a bit of a strange way of an analyst to look at it, to be excited about a business that's spending more money on costs. But there's two reasons to be still, I think, okay about it. One is, even after doing that, you've got a business with 30% profit margins and fairly similar numbers in terms of return on capital, even after that spend. And I think it builds a barrier to entry for anybody else. And whatever one might accuse Mr. Zuckerberg of, and I don't know him personally, so I won't accuse him of anything personally, stupidity doesn't strike me as highly likely. And I think that he realizes that he needs to spend the money because of what's happened. I think he realizes that by doing so, he shows that he's doing something. I think he realizes it builds a barrier to entry as well. And he realizes that if the choice is between doing all these things and responding, spending the extra $35 billion and doing all that, or showing supernormal profit margins in the 60% bracket, I think he knows that's not wise at the moment to do so. I mean, I don't know if we've reached the end on Facebook, but if I left a thought with you, it would be this. When you're thinking about a business like this, I mean, maybe the thought of people who ask about Facebook, including Mr. Zimmerman, is it's just going to disappear, right? Which it's possible. But I mean, it's got 2 billion users, and these users are, you know, not just on Facebook, there's things like WhatsApp as well, which in many respects is a close to ubiquitous communications tool now for people as well. But if you think it's going to disappear, fine. If you think that what's going to happen is somehow reduces the business's profitability and its competitive stance, can you just answer the following question for me? Who is the competitor that you think may come past it then exactly? Because I can't actually think of one.
Okay, that's Facebook. Clearly, we have no remorse about our investment in that.
Well, I wish I bought more of it after it fell than before it fell. I've got a lot of remorse about that.